Hi, my name is Megan Rossman. I'm the public horticulture intern here at Scott Arboretum. And for this gardener's almanac, we'll be going over anthotype and cyanotype prints. So. Photograms are images produced by laying a object or a negative over a piece of paper or fabric that have been treated with a light sensitive solution. So in both of the case of anthotype and cyanotype, they are types of photograms using different chemicals and solutions. Anthotypes are prints using chemical extracts from plants. In this case, I'm using turmeric powder, which contains curcumin, to create this reaction. And with cyanotypes, I'm using potassium phenocyanide and ammonium citrate to create this reaction. These can be used with a variety of objects. Today I'm going to be using plants. I have some plants that are not dried, such as this fern. I also have some other plants that I dried because they are more 3D in structure, like this astilbe. We're going to start with anthotype prints, which is the print using plant extracts. So you will definitely need some supplies. You're going to need watercolor paper or something that can be immersed in water without falling apart, whether that's a fabric or another type of paper. You also are going to need isopropyl alcohol, 91% or greater, turmeric powder, borax for developing, and then you're going to need a plate to protect the surface. You could also use newspaper, and you're going to want measuring and mixing supplies, as well as a large basin for your borax water mixture for developing. And then finally, the most fun part is you're also going to need some plants or your negatives. So this is the process when making anthotype prints. You're going to want to mix your turmeric and isopropyl alcohol in a 4-to-1 ratio. So 4 parts isopropyl alcohol, 91% or greater, and 1 part turmeric. In this case, I just did teaspoons. So I did 4 teaspoons alcohol and 1 teaspoon turmeric, and I mixed that up in a little cup with a paintbrush. I also took my watercolor paper and cut it into a smaller size. I'm using the plate so that the turmeric powder doesn't stain the table because it will soak through the paper. And I'm just going to go ahead and paint the surface. You can absolutely paint it in any way you want. If you want to go all the way to the edge, that is totally cool. I kind of like leaving a little bit of a border, just that's my preference. I like to be able to write stuff kind of in that border, whether it's the name of the plants or the date. Kind of whatever you want. Some of the turmeric won't mix in. That's kind of the little powder you're seeing. And that will wipe right off once it's dried. So you can really just coat the surface. That turmeric really is prominent in color. And then, yeah, it doesn't have to be perfect as long as you get the area that you want coated. As you can see, some of that turmeric is coming off. And once that's dry, I'll just wipe that off. So I'm going to go ahead and set that aside just because I want it to fully dry. And I'm going to take some paper that I prepared a little bit ago. As you see, I've wiped off that extra turmeric. It has bled over onto the other side, and I'm going to use the side that I painted on. I'm going to go ahead and take some of the Japanese maple leaves because I think those look really cool, as I've done here. And I'm also going to take this allium that I dried the other day. And what I'm going to do with those, and as I'm going to press them between two pieces of plexiglass or glass, whatever works for you, and I'm going to put binder clips to secure them. I'm then going to place this in the sun for 2 to 3 hours, and you want direct sunlight on those. Thankfully, I've already let this one sit out, so I'm going to go ahead and develop it. I'm going to unclip it from the glass. If you can't find two pieces of glass or plexiglass, you can have one clear object on top and one just solid object on the back, like cardboard. That totally works too. I'm going to lift it off and then just gently peel these off. You can see that some exposure has already been going on there, and that's only going to get more prominent. In this basin here, I have a mixture of 1/2 cup water to 2 teaspoons borax. I've obviously times that by 4 just to get a little bit more full in this basin, but that ratio is 1/2 cup water to 2 teaspoons borax. And I'm just going to go ahead. It's okay if it's a little bit not fully mixed in. The borax doesn't always like to dissolve fully. I'm just going to go ahead and dip that in there and make sure this paper gets all wet. It's kind of instant, the reaction. You can see that the negative space where my objects were gets really dark, and that's what we're wanting. So as you let this kind of go through there, it's just going to get darker and darker in that negative space. When it stops changing color, you're going to take it out and just rinse it under the sink to get all that excess borax off. But I'm actually going to let this sit in here a little bit longer just to see if it continues to develop. So that is the process for anthotype prints. You can do this with a variety of plant extracts. If you have beetroot powder, you can do it with that. A lot of people will take dried strawberries and raspberries and mix those up. So you can really play around with it, and it's a great way to use the beautiful colors that are in your garden and also preserve maybe the dried flowers like we've done in our past video. But you can also use live flowers as well, as long as they're flat. So we just went over anthotype printing, which again is using plant extracts to create a photogram. Now we will be talking about cyanotype. Cyanotype is probably more common than anthotype. I feel like you see this a lot on Instagram, or a lot in public arts have this in it as well. So it's pretty commonplace, but it's super fun to do and super easy. So there's a couple ways you can do it. You can absolutely buy the chemical solutions online that come in a liquid form. You can go ahead and mix those chemicals, and then you can treat your own paper or fabric. I prefer to just get the pre-prepared paper. It makes it pretty easy. I don't have to work with the chemicals as much. Especially with kids, working with the chemicals, they are safe, and you can reference the safety data sheets, and they're not super harmful chemicals, but you always want to be careful. So if you do choose to use the liquid chemicals, wear gloves, make sure you're wearing clothing that you don't mind getting ruined. Same with the anthotype. But I just choose to use the pre-prepared paper. I don't have to mix anything. I just need water, some flowers, and I'm ready to go. So just to go over supplies once again, you're going to need some flat objects, whether they're dry or just freshly picked. You're going to want your pre-prepared paper. It comes in quite a few different sizes. I just happen to have this size here. You can tell that it's already been treated because of the discoloration there. And then you're going to need your plexiglass contraption with some binder clips to keep it flat while it's in the sun. So for this, you just take your pre-prepared paper, whether you treated it or bought it prepared. You're going to place the objects on there. Ferns are my favorite personally, but I've also got some cat's whiskers here, and I might maybe put that there. And then you're going to put it between your glass contraption. This process is much quicker than the anthotype. The anthotype takes 2 to 3 hours to develop. The cyanotype takes 5 to 20 minutes. So you can definitely mess around with how long you're going to leave it in the sun and see how that development, you know, changes its look. I went ahead and left this one out in the sun for about 15 minutes, so I'm excited to see what happens. I'm going to unclip it. In here I have some ferns, and I also dried an echinacea blossom in there. You can see that, you know, the chemical process has started here. Those areas where the negatives were are white. And I'm going to go ahead and just dip this in plain water. Super, super easy. It takes a little bit longer than anthotype to develop, so you may have to leave it in the water just for a little bit longer. You can start to see around the edges that it's getting a little bit blue. You can do it in either warm or cold water. It's not really going to matter. And you just kind of swish it around till it develops. So as you can see, as we continue to leave this in the water, it's slowly going to change. The developing process for the cyanotype does take much longer than the anthotype, which was kind of an instantaneous process. So you're really just going to let this sit, continue to develop. It may create kind of some of these funny little bubbles on there. That's okay, just keep letting it develop. Eventually it'll start to turn darker blue, kind of a Prussian blue like this, and that's when you know it's ready. And you can just wipe it off with some paper towels and you'll be ready to go. These make great postcards or gifts, and it's just another great way, along with pressing flowers, to preserve your garden. When creating cyanotype and anthotype prints, it is important to follow safety practices, even though these are relatively safe processes. So I would recommend wearing gloves if you do not feel comfortable exposing your skin to the borax or the isopropyl alcohol. I would also recommend eyewear if you're working with small kids, because the isopropyl alcohol and the borax can be harmful to the eyes. If you're working with the chemicals and you're developing the chemicals yourself, absolutely wear gloves. And for both processes, I would suggest wearing clothing that you don't mind getting stained, especially with the turmeric that stains both skin and clothing, so be careful with that. When working with kids, I would suggest the anthotype process over the cyanotype process. This does contain a little bit more chemicals, and I think the process of developing the anthotype is a little bit more spontaneous and quick, and it's really fun to watch kids and as they see like that exciting change.